Brother Jim Richardson is going to be bringing the word tonight. So pray for that and anything else, of course, that's on your heart.
Good evening. May we keep in prayer our pastor and his family and
yes.
Who's traveling. So let's pray for their travel mercies and that they have a peaceful and restful vacation. Let's also pray for our nation that right now needs it the most. And most of all, may we pray for Brother Richardson, that he brings us the word that will open our eyes so that our hearts will fall and soften to the word. Father, thank you for bringing us all here together safely tonight. Thank you for the deliverance of this church, for the deliverance of our family, just for the love that your grace places on these walls. We can ask only that we hear the words that will be delivered tonight and that we cherish in your Son's name. Amen.
Good evening, everybody. It's a nice crowd tonight. Glad everybody can make it out here. Definitely pray for Brother Richardson. He needs it. But as of right now, do we have any first-time visitors here tonight? Any first-time visitors? Hey, amen. We got a brother right here. So please, we're just going to have a welcome time. We're going to go around, be friendly, shake some hands, and say hello to everybody.
I'm not invisible over here.
You gonna give me a fist bump?
Worship Christ the Lord. Have the ushers come forward at this time? Appreciate these gentlemen very much. It's a pleasure, a privilege to work with these guys. They're precious to my heart. Thank you so much for it. Well, great opportunity God's given to us, and we can give back just a little bit to Him. Remember, every dollar that we put in here represents a soul. And what kind of value can you put on the soul? Just good to the Lord. Father God, I give you thank you greatly for this privilege, what a privilege it is. To stand here, Lord, we bow our head before you, God. We thank you for the opportunity to come before your throne through your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, God, we do ask that you would use this offering to further the gospel here, and just one more soul will be worth it all. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
I'm going to let you all know something. I got to speak in tongues today. I got to preach at the Chinese church. I did have an interpreter, though.
Cantonese?
No, Mandarin.
Mandarin.
Take the name of Jesus with you. Child of sorrow and of woe, it will joy and comfort give you. Take it everywhere you go. Precious name, oh how sweet, hope of earth and joy of man. Precious name, oh how sweet. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for doing that. All right, kids, you may be dismissed. It is your time to make your exodus. But there will be over there one day. Who still needs a prayer sheet for the Chase Williams Illusions? Did anyone still need that? All right. Who will be my volunteer to go to the printer, because I forgot to cut them up after printing them and hand them out to these few? Thanks, Cameron. You needed one, so you might as well. All right, so that is for next year. We're planning to do that, but we're preparing in prayer. Anyone involved in any of the schools in the area, please get with me and we can get set up being able to reach out into the schools. All right. Remember those prayer booklets. I'm curious, who is up to date? They've been doing their prayer every day. Nice. We're getting some prayer. Praise the Lord. We're accomplishing much there. We're not accomplishing much there. We're depending on the Lord to accomplish much there. Praise the Lord for that. God will work. God will work. He will do his work. Now, remember that missions, special missions project, where you have that special offering. That's August 4th. And the idea there is I think it's kind of like a pre-missions conference special offering to just make that effort, have it on our minds, and be able to continue thinking on the things that God would have us to do with our involvement in reaching the world, not just our area personally, but being able beyond that. Now, we're not talking about, let's pray about how much we can, what's the word? How much we can, not administrate. What's the word? The thing Dad needs to do.
Orchestrate.
Some of that too, but.
Orchestrate.
What's it called?
Orchestrate.
Where you give it to someone else.
Delegate.
Delegation. Now, we're not delegating our evangelism to these missionaries. That's not what we're doing. We're not praying about how much can we give of our money so that we don't have to give of ourselves to evangelism. That's not what we're praying about. We're praying about how much more can we accomplish being able to help others as well in their evangelism effort accomplished throughout the world. And we want to do that as a church. We want to accomplish every which way God would have us to. Continue to pray for Dad. Now, we're going to do something different for evangelism the next 2 or 3 weeks. So, for outreach on Tuesdays, Thursdays, and Fridays, we're going to do it where we meet at the location we're actually going to be at. So, don't come here anymore. Those of you that go on evangelism during those times, don't meet here. You can get a hold of Pastor Mike, and he'll have the area we're going to. This Tuesday, to get you started, we're going to meet at Holly Branch, all right, in Delmar, Delaware. And if you need a reminder of that, just get a hold of me. I know that, and especially Pastor Michael. He's coordinating the areas. So that's what we'll be doing, and we'll just pray there, take our time there, and be done about 5. So we'll just take that time starting at 4 on Tuesdays and Thursdays, and at 10 on Saturdays. All right? So we'll be in the Del Mar area this Tuesday. Now, this Friday is that movie, right?
Yeah.
And so there's movie night. What time is that? Does everyone know already? Do we have any deal?
Yeah, it's
6. Excellent.
Yeah.
So that'll be coming this Friday. Now the 28th, we have some baptisms. So if you're needing to be baptized, you can talk to me. We'll set you up, have you ready to go if you're in need of baptism. All right. Now, I think, that was the thing I needed to mention was, for some reason, the movie didn't get on here, so I need to make sure that was mentioned. Yeah, it's up there. It's on the screens, but I didn't have it in the bulletin. This Saturday is our deep clean. It can be super. You can make it super. Get the, we're going to go to the store, get the very best cleaner. It's going to be super deep clean Saturday, all right? We'll do that after evangelism. So we'll be, that'll be around 12:30. That we'll be here for a couple hours. We'll just deep clean everything. Let me tell you, the blue room, I was organizing the blue room. The blue room needs a deep clean. So if you want to know what really needs a deep clean anytime, do the blue room. Blue room is all the way in the corner over there in the social hall. A little bit neglected out of the way, I guess. So I think that'll be a blessing to what age group is that? That's Julia's age group for Sunday school. So it'll be a blessing to them. I'm a little bit cleaner. All right. And then you'll see up there some more announcements in your bulletin of things that are coming up, and you can be familiar, and those have the, if you need any details on that, always feel free to ask. All right, we're going to give the rest of the time to our brother Jim Richardson this evening. Now, he preached not that long ago, right? You got to bring us the word. Now, I missed it. I don't know. So, I get to enjoy it tonight. I get to see how good you are. You got practice already. Yeah, you're all set. All right, come on up, brother.
All right.
I'm going to just crack this one.
He's talking about the blue room. I thought that was kind of cool. In prison, we had a pink room. We had a pink room. Then, of course, you know, with our everything that's changed, now they can't have a pink room anymore, you know, because of the LGBT and all that stuff. But anyhow, yeah, it's good to have you out tonight, really. And you continue to pray for Pastor Barry and his vacation, and hope that they have a good time. And when I think about, I don't know if you ever think about it, but I think how in the world, and I know he has Pastor Tom and Mike and Dave, but you think about all the things he coordinates and puts together. That's a lot of stuff, you know. That's a mess of stuff.
Yeah.
And so tonight, and I appreciate my neighbors coming out tonight. That's cool. Great to have you here. I appreciate everybody that's been praying for my buddy. He couldn't come tonight because of his surgery, but he'll be my critique later. But if it goes on the line, he'll check it out and get me straightened out. But I appreciate you coming out. And tonight, we're going to preach about some things tonight. We're going to talk about... let's take our Bible and turn to Job chapter 3. I'm going to start there. We'll use this as kind of like a springboard. And we're going to turn to the scriptures tonight. And she said she likes to turn, my granddaughter said she likes to turn to the scriptures. So I like when you turn to the scriptures too. It's Job 3:25. You want to put it on the board. But you know, back... when I got saved, when I was going to camp meetings and revival meetings at church, I love hearing the pages turn. You know, we have some old cassette tapes, and my mom has an old player, and we play it. And you know, it's kind of they're really getting poor quality, but man, you can still hear those pages turn on that tape. And you say, well, what's that mean? I like that better than a screen, wouldn't you? And the thing I don't like about the screen is when we open up God's Word, we see God's Word. We don't have to worry about somebody popping up, you know, something crazy popping up and taking our minds away from God's Word. It's a sad thing when we come to an age and got to the place where people, and I look things up on my phone, I'm not saying that, but the thing that a lot of preachers and preaching that's going on now is off of a phone or a tablet.
Yeah.
Now, to me, that's not God's word, because you got the devil side and God's side working all out the same thing. When I started preaching, believe this or not, it's been a year or two, preachers were preaching against the World Wide Web. They were. They were talking about it's damned and it's hell and it's, you know, and it is really. I mean, you can use it that way. But man, they were just screaming about it every message you'd hear. They always brought up the World Wide Web. Now everybody's got it. That's right. So tonight, as a springboard, Job chapter 3, verse 25, the Bible says, "For the thing which I greatly fear is come upon me, and that which I was afraid of is come unto me." My Father, thank you tonight we can come out to your house. Father, thank you tonight for the people that are here. God, I pray that you'd speak to their hearts, Lord. You'd speak through me somehow, some way, Lord. And you would just use it, Lord, to encourage them, rebuke them, bless them. Lord, whatever they might need tonight, Lord, they came here. And Lord, just the fact that they came here means that they're looking for something. And I pray, God, you give them something to take home with them. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, now when I look at this verse here in Job 3, and when you think about the book of Job, and you study the book of Job, which we're not really going to talk about Job, like I said, he's in the springboard. He said, "For the thing which I greatly feared has come upon me, and that which I was afraid of has come unto me." Now, when you think about Job, Job didn't have a Bible. Like, we should know everything, really, that's going on around us right now and really understand it because God put it in print. There's nothing that's going to happen that's going to catch God by surprise. You agree? Nothing. I mean, when you go back, you know, and listen, man, I prayed for Donald Trump, and I think compared to Joe, I'm not doing a political thing here tonight, but it doesn't matter who the president is. If Donald Trump becomes president, it might help our gas prices, it may help our food prices, but we still know what's coming down the road. You read Daniel chapter 2, and you see that image that Daniel tells King Nebuchadnezzar, starting out with the gold and the silver and the brass and the iron and the clay. You already know that's the whole Gentile kingdom from beginning to end. Yes. And then the rock rolls in and crushes it all. Yeah. Hallelujah. That's right. When Jesus comes back, it's not going to be a gradual thing of things getting better. It's going to be bam. That's it. That's what's happening. You said, "I don't know if I believe that." You better. You believe in Easter Bunny. You ought to be able to believe in Jesus. That's right. That's right. So, when I was reading this verse, there's some things that I really fear. So I start thinking about things that I really fear. I work for the Department of Corrections. I mean, we drove 90 miles an hour on the way home from Wilmington, from Ganderville Prison. We never got a ticket. We didn't. Am I right, John? I mean, we drove crazy and erratically. We never got a ticket. But there's something that bothers me about getting a ticket. And so I kind of fear the police, you know, pulling up behind you and the lights on. I fear going into a courtroom, you know, standing before a judge. When you think about all those things, think about standing before God.
Yeah.
So I said, "Well, I fear the police. I fear the court." And I think every man fears his wife. I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding with you, but. But, so I looked up some things that America fears. They fear, I wrote it down, they fear the budget deficit.
Yeah.
They fear unemployment.
Yeah.
They fear illegal immigration.
Yeah.
They fear crime. Mm-hmm. They fear gun violence. Mm-hmm. They fear gun control. Yeah. They fear climate change.
Yeah.
Why would you fear climate change? Why? Listen, I heard an old message. Oliver B. Green said this. He said, "You don't have to worry about ever destroying the world. God saved that for himself."
Yeah.
That's right. You're not going to do it. And besides, if Jesus comes tonight, this is going to last 1,007 more years.
Yeah.
If the Bible's true.
Amen.
That's right.
It is.
So why would we fear? You know, I don't care, you know, if you want to cut your what's that thing called, Mike, that keeps your exhaust from messing up? The converter.
Cadillac.
Cut your Cadillac converter off. You can't. You'll get locked up from DMV, but hey, I've never cut mine off my Z28. Man, I love that thing.
Yeah.
Cut that converter off. Man, she was so loud, she rubbed it. Just like she could breathe. Kind of like if you took the tile. I got good fast here. But let's take our Bible here and let's turn. The thing I think that we should fear tonight is I believe we ought to fear the judgment seat of Christ.
That's right.
You know, I listen to preachers all the time, all the time, all the time. And very rarely do you hear any preacher preaching from a pulpit on the judgment seat of Christ. You rarely hear church people talking about the judgment seat of Christ.
That's
very rare. Now, the Bible talks a whole lot about the judgment seat of Christ. So let's turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 5. 2 Corinthians 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. I'm going to turn there. So I like it when you look at it. I like hearing the pages turn. If you don't want to turn, that's okay. But let's read here in verse number 10. The Bible says, Paul wrote here in 2 Corinthians, "For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that everyone may receive the things done in his body according to that he hath done, whether it be good or bad." Now, we're not preaching in this church work salvation.
Right.
But when you got saved, did God just save you for one day? I'm saved. What are you going to do for, some of you might live another 50 years. What are you going to do for 50 years? I'm saved. That's not what God left you here for.
That's right.
And that's the reason why there's going to be a judgment seat of Christ, because you're going to have an account of the things that you've done.
Yeah.
Since you've been saved.
Yes, sir. That's right.
All right. Now, he said we must all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. And the next verse goes like this. It says, "Knowing therefore the terror of the Lord." Now, that wouldn't fit in most churches today, would it? Jesus loved temple. And, you know, love, love, love. I understand Jesus Christ is a loving God. But God is also a balanced being. True or false? If God's got this much love, there's got to be this much what?
Yeah.
Wrath. That's right. You know, people today, it's like they have, you know, they wear that stuff that says no fear. Can you imagine looking Jesus Christ, looking him right in his eyeballs? He's not going to be a baby in a manger. And I believe this, now I don't know what you believe, but I believe over in Revelation, all the tears aren't wiped away until after the judgment seat of Christ.
That's right.
1 Corinthians chapter 3. While you're there, let's look at 1 Corinthians chapter, I believe it's chapter 3. I don't have my notes, but pretty sure 1 Corinthians chapter 3. All right. Verse number 11, or verse 10. "According to the grace of God, which is given unto me as a wise master builder, I have laid the foundation, and another buildeth thereon. But let every man take heed how he build thereon, for other foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ." Preacher's just preaching on that Wednesday night. Verse 12. "Now, if any man build upon this foundation gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, or stubble, every man's work shall be manifest, for the day shall declare it, because it shall be revealed by fire, and the fire shall try every man's work of what sort it is." God's going to try our work. Now, you see there the precious stones and the gold. That's all the stuff that's going to come through that you did for Jesus. It's going to amount to something. And the wood and the stubble is going to burn up. So what am I going to do for Jesus Christ? And for time reasons, another verse, Romans chapter 14, verse 10, talks about the judgment seat of Christ. I didn't just pick one verse. Romans 14, 10, and you throw that up there. But why dost thou judge thy brother? Why dost thou set another brother? For we shall all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. It's not just mentioned one time. The judgment seat of Christ is really going to happen. We don't believe in a general judgment as many churches and religions do. You know, a lot of churches believe in this general judgment. Not Baptists, but a lot of people would believe in a general judgment. If I did enough good, I'll go this way. If I did enough bad, I'm going that way. That's not how it is.
That's right.
There's a judgment seat of Christ for the Christian, and there's a white throne judgment for the lost.
That's right.
Amen. That's what's going to happen.
Yeah.
And we need to think about those things as Christians. You said, why would you hammer us? I'm not hammering you. I'm warning you. The Bible tells us to warn you. And any message that you'll ever hear me preach in this church, I'm preaching it to me. Because I need it myself. I need it to be rekindled in my heart, my mind. Because we're prone to wonder. Prone to wonder. Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Constantly, no matter how old you get, the flesh doesn't want to serve God.
That's right.
There's not going to be any excuses. There's not going to be, you're not going to be able to blame your culture or your family or the government. It's going to be you and God at the judgment seat of Christ.
Right.
And, you know, you can say this to a lost man if you want to, but the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 31, it is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. That's the truth. And you say, well, I'm saved. Well, you know there's five crowns listed, at least five, right? Five crowns in your Bible. Incorruptible crown, overcomer's crown, soul winner crown. There's at least five crowns that you can get at that judgment seat of Christ. And Michael, if I was standing there, and you were Jesus, and somebody else is standing here, and they got crowns to throw at you, and I'm standing here empty, that's a terrible feeling.
Yes, it is. Yeah.
That's a terrible feeling.
Yeah.
Don't you feel bad if you go to, say, your family has a cookout, and you show up, and don't you feel bad if you don't bring a cake or food or drinks or something? You feel bad about it. How much more should you feel at the judgment seat of Christ?
Yeah,
to not be able to give them back. And you know what? We can think about it. We can say, well, I'm going to think about that. I'm going to just, listen, time's running out. You're not going to lead one person to Christ. You're not going to do anything for Christ once that rapture takes place. So, that's it. There's no, like they do in the schools now, you can take a retest. There ain't going to be a retest.
That's right.
It's over. It's done at that point. All right? Judgment seat of Christ doesn't decide whether we go to heaven or hell. It decides on what we did for Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Jesus said, behold, I come quickly. Revelation 22, verse 12. Jesus said, or the Bible says in Revelation 22, 12, behold, I come quickly. My reward is with me to give every man according to his work shall be. We're going to give an account. Romans 14, verse 12 says, so then every one of us shall give an account of himself to God. That's a personal account. If you're a child here today and you're saved, you're going to give an account to Jesus Christ. That's a lot. That's a lot to think about. You say, well, I pay my bills. I raise my kids. I've been faithful to my wife. So is the heathen. There's people up and down the streets that live on your block or live on your road that they've done all that their whole life. They still won't go to hell if they're not lost, if they're not saved.
That's right. Yeah.
And if they're Christians, if they haven't done anything for Jesus, they're still going to be empty at the judgment seat of Christ.
That's right.
Because the things that we do for Christ are eternal. As I remember, this was a long time ago, when they had Garrett's ordination and I was sitting over here. It's been so long, Garrett, I had to go back and look and see what year I was ordained. It was 1992. That's been a day or two. And I remember sitting there, and we didn't have any, you know, those days we didn't have anything that you know, we didn't have anything the night before, anything. You just walked in there, and they questioned you. And there's always a preacher there that wants to just either show you everything he knows, or he just wants to get you embarrassed so you get messed up, you know. Yeah. But I remember sitting there, Michael, you better not laugh. You're coming up, aren't you? I'm going to be there, Michael. I'm just messing with you, bro. But listen, I was so nervous. I was just like this. And I thought, and the Lord said, man, and his best things all together being me. And he just kept giving me verse after verse about man. And these preachers were undoubtedly great men. I'm not saying that.
Yeah, yeah.
But when you compare them to Jesus Christ,
yeah,
I was like, okay, Lord, I'm ready to do this now. Yeah, not with confidence of the flesh, but I was confident that I could go up there with Jesus Christ.
That's
good. That's right. And I was so amazed at what, and I don't want to lift you up too much because that might cause a problem, but I was just so amazed how that man did.
Amen.
I was like, good man, that's awesome. Man, that's awesome. You know, that's good. That's great. But I remember being so scared, but then I thought about one day I'm going to stand before Jesus Christ and get counted.
Yes.
Stuff.
Yes.
I'm scared then.
Yeah. That's and that's just a piece of paper.
Yeah.
I'm going to go to race through some now. I'm sorry, I'm not going to be a few old verse, but some of the things that we're going to give an account for at this judgment seat of Christ, we're going to give an account of our words.
Oh, yes.
Our words.
Oh, yes.
The Bible says every idle word. Matthew chapter 12, verse 36 talks about our idle words. And I, you know, I understand that people really, and Christians and stuff, because of being conservative, they really get into politics and this and that. I'm going to tell you something. If we spend more time talking about politics and about Jesus Christ, there's a lot of idle words in that.
That's right.
The Bible says, what's it say in over Proverbs? A multitude of words.
There's no one for sin.
That's right. No one for sin. Every time you speak, listen, if you can talk to anybody 20, 30 minutes, an hour, and never bring up Jesus Christ, you are in trouble. I don't care if it's your family. I don't care who it is. If you can't say God's blessed me or God's done something, that means God's not in all of your thoughts.
Yeah.
Got a problem.
Right.
We're going to give account of our words. We're going way deeper tonight, aren't we, than short dresses and toes out of your shoes and seeing your arms. That's what all the preachers are preaching on tonight. They don't have anything else to preach on because their people wouldn't come back to church. They got to preach on the things that they don't do.
That's right.
We're preaching on things tonight that we do as Christians, as meek Christians, as Christians that have been saved 20, 30 years. That's what we're preaching tonight. I had an old preacher that evangelist was a mentor. I had two or three of them, but one he said, Jim, and said, if all you can preach on is dress code, Jim, why don't you just don't even preach? You know why?
Yeah.
Because if you have to preach a dress code to people constantly, they're not reading their Bible.
Yes, sir. Right.
You didn't have to tell me how to dress. You didn't have to say, hey, you need to quit drinking. You didn't have to say you need to quit partying. When you pick up the Bible and you read it, you see it. Yeah. Nobody has. And then you know who? Yeah. You know who preached it to you then? God Almighty did.
Yeah.
You didn't have to listen to some cockeyed preacher get up there and waste your time.
Yeah.
Your words. Your words you give account. You're going to give an account of your words. Let's skip the rest of that. You're going to give an account of your secrets. The Bible says in Romans chapter 2, verse 16, that's out my front yard right now. So if you drive by my house, you see that verse. You see that verse, Charlie? It says, in the day when God shall judge the secrets of men by Jesus Christ. That's right. Psalm 90 verse 8, give you the same thing. Talk about judging our secrets. For time, we'll go skip that. We'll just leave it at that. Psalm 90 verse 8, Romans chapter 2 verse 16. All right, let's go to the next point. We talked about our words. We talked about our secrets, some things that we fear. We're going to give an account the way we worship God. That's right. We're going to give an account. You know, a guy told me one time, he said, you know, Jim, he said, I just think you're so heavenly minded, you're earthly good. I don't think I've ever met anybody like that. Have you? I've never met anybody who was so heavenly minded they were no earthly good. We're all more earthly than we are heavenly most of the time.
Yeah, that's right.
But you're going to give an account of the way that you worship God.
Right.
The Bible says in Hebrews 13, verse 15, Hebrews 13, verse 15, the Bible says that we're to offer the sacrifice of praise to God continually. That is the fruit of our lips giving thanks to His name.
Yeah.
You're going to give an account of your worship.
Yeah.
You said, well, I'm not going to shout. Well, then don't. You can stay tight-lipped, pooch-lipped, don't make a difference any way you want to. But you're going to give an account for it.
Yes, sir.
Amen.
And when somebody gets up and says, amen, hallelujah.
The end of that speaker.
When somebody does that, there's always somebody says, what's wrong with him? What's wrong with her? What's wrong with them? But they just want to give God some worship.
Amen.
You know what? But that same person will sit on their couch when this fall comes and when their team's playing and it's down to the, they're in the last whatever it is, quarter or whatever, and the last few seconds and they get to kick a field goal and somebody gets up there and kicks that field goal and their team wins, they sit there like this.
No,
they don't. They're screaming and yelling and jumping and hollering. That's what they're doing. Listen, when that fellow right there, Mr. Hale, Brother Hale, when he gets up there and sings, I tell you what, especially when they're old hymns, brother, my hair stands up on the back of my neck. When you sing, if nobody else was singing but you, I tell you what, if the preacher preached the worst message ever, just that I got to hear you sing made me go home feeling happy. You know what? That causes you to worship God. That's right. And you know what? You can say, hey, you're just in the flesh. You're just in the flesh. Well, you're in the flesh all the time anyway. If you have to shout on credit, what's wrong with that? That's right. Alright, so you're going to give an account of the way you worship God. Psalm 86 verse 12 is another verse. I mean, if you get a concordance, I still do it the old way, throw my old big book concordance out, and you look up that word worship, and there's pages of it, pages of it, pages of it.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, man, there's, I mean, worshiping God is important.
Yeah.
I tell you, the next thing we're going to talk about real quick is we're going to give an account for our wounds, on how we took our wounds. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, we're going to read a few of these verses, because these days in churches, people just get so offended. Our whole country, everybody's offended. Somebody hurt somebody's feelings. 2 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse number 23, the Bible says, on earthly ministers of Christ, I speak as a fool. I am more in labors, more abundant, in stripes above measure, in prisons more frequent, in depths oft of the Jews five times received I 40 stripes, save one. Thrice was I beaten with rods.
Yeah.
Once was I stoned. Thrice I suffered shipwreck. A night and a day I have been in the deep. In journeys often, in perils of water, in perils of robbers, in perils by my own countrymen. My own countrymen. In perils by the heathen. In perils in the city. In perils in the wilderness. In perils in the sea. In perils among false brethren. In weariness and painfulness. In watching often. In hunger and thirst. And fasting often. In cold and nakedness. This verse is the one I love, really love this next. 28. Besides those things that are without, that which cometh upon me daily, the care of all the churches.
Yeah.
How about that?
Yeah.
The care of the church, it might be better to get a whipping. Man, that's hard to take right there, brother. Know where you're going. Yeah. It might be better to be out in the wilderness than be in the church. What the church people do to you. That's a sad thing. You're going to give an account of your wounds. And you know what's the saddest thing about when we give account of our wounds is when we get wounded and quit church, you know what really happens? Then our kids don't go to church anymore. Then our kids grow up and they end up in hell. Or they end up going down the wrong road. Because we got offended because somebody said something to us in church that we didn't like. And we got our feelings hurt.
Yeah.
You haven't been beat with 39 stripes yet.
That's right.
No one in here has.
That's
so
right.
Why would you be offended and want to quit going to church?
Shame on.
I tell you what, I could give you account after account after account of men in the Bible that got offended by something that happened by either God or their own people.
Yeah.
And their life ended up in tragedy. Suicide. Their kids. Look at Solomon.
Yeah.
Solomon's life. Look at the reason why I was thinking about Solomon. Because Solomon, he had everything. And Proverbs, what is it? Proverbs 1:7. It says at the beginning, wisdom. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Solomon had all that going on. But all Solomon's riches, and as his life goes on, and he ends up marrying a Moabitess woman and a whole bunch of other women he shouldn't have been involved with. And then their son becomes a king, and it's just a total disaster. Then when he writes Ecclesiastes, he said, hey, this is the whole thing. After the whole circle, fear God.
Amen.
He finally figured it out. But look what it cost him.
Yeah, everything.
It cost him everything. You can read man after man after man that it costs them everything. It's not worth losing your kids because you got offended in church. It's not. You're going to give an account of your wounds at the judgment seat of Christ.
That's good.
The Bible says in Acts chapter 5, verse 40, it says that after they beat them, they were glad that they were counted worthy to suffer shame for his name. Yeah. You know, we get so upset when we pass out a gospel tract, give somebody a gospel tract, when they laugh or sneer at us. Why? Why? That's nothing compared to what we just said.
Yeah, right.
Give an account of our wounds. You think about David. David, the Bible, David said that, he said, I was wounded in the house of my friends. If you think about, and if you want to read the story of Ahithophel, that was his counselor. That's who they went in and had sweet counsel together before God. But Ahithophel got offended at David's life with Bathsheba, which, hey, he was wrong. It was sin. But that gave him reason. This is what Ahithophel, this is important. I'm going to take the time for this one. Ahithophel thought that because of David's sin with Bathsheba, that he was right in lining up with Absalom.
Yeah, that's true.
That destroyed him.
Yeah,
it destroyed him. He was like talking to God. He was the middleman for God. But he said, I'm not going to forgive David. But God did. And God will forgive some of you folks in here. God will forgive you. And other people might not. But it'll be to their own destruction, not yours.
Yeah.
That's right. And you know what he did? Then he went out and committed suicide. Such a man of God and the power of God on his life. Your wounds. Give an account of them. I'm not going to look at these because my time's out. We're getting close. You're going to give an account of your spending, your selfishness, your sleep, your separation, and your time.
Right. Those are all true.
You said, well, as long as I'm saved and going to heaven, I don't care. You're wrong.
Yeah.
You're going to face a great, big awakening one of these days.
Yeah.
Now, I want to finish up with this one. I fear, not only at this judgment seat of Christ, I fear the blood that will be on my hands at the judgment seat of Christ.
Oh, that's right.
Ezekiel chapter 33.
Right.
Ezekiel chapter 33. Ezekiel chapter 33, and we're going to read verse number 8. All these chapters previous and all these chapters around here are just great verses for what I'm talking about now, but for time we're not going to do it. But verse 8, it says, when I say to the wicked, O wicked man, thou shalt surely die. If thou doest not speak to warn the wicked from his way, that wicked man shall die in his iniquity, but his blood will I require at thine hand. Think about all the people that you know that you've been too ashamed to tell about Jesus Christ. It might be your family member. It might be your neighbor. It might be your co-workers. But right now, if I took and cut my arm and had blood all over my hands, you wouldn't want to shake hands with me. You wouldn't want to touch me, would you? But you think about all the blood that you and I have on our hands of people. Hey, when you witness in Walmart, that's a good thing, brother. You Amen. Keep doing it. I understand you have to do it discreetly, but you keep doing it.
Amen.
Because God will honor that.
Amen.
Michael, at your job, wherever you are, you just keep
yes, sir.
Carrying it on.
Yeah.
You keep witnessing. Listen, the Mormons and the Jehovah's Witnesses, they don't even have any security in their religion.
Yeah.
You know when
yes.
you die.
Amen.
When
you're born.
Yeah.
How much blood will we have on our hands when we stand
Come
at
on,
the
brother.
Judgment seat of Christ? When you think about that, that should make you scared.
Yes, it does.
That should make you scared.
It's frightening.
Jude 22.
Yeah.
Jude 22, the little book right before Revelation. Jude 22 and 23. And some have compassion, making a difference. Some people be real sweet, kind to when them. And others save with fear, pulling them out of the fire, hating even the garment spotted by the flesh. If I saw my granddaughter getting ready to walk out front of a car, you think I'd say, hey, you need to get out of that car.
Right?
Now, you know what I'd do? I'd pull her and I'd snatch her. I did that case because I didn't want to hurt someone else bad. But you understand what I'm saying? We would snatch them out of the way.
Yes.
Right.
Out of the fire. Is it not real, though? Is the Bible just an old relic book? Is it like going to a museum downtown? That Bible says if you let that word work on you, it'll hit you like a hammer. And it'll break into pieces. And it'll take your hard, cold, stony heart and hit it and hit it and hit it until you become pliable that God can use you. Is that your desire? If not, just go home tonight and pretend you didn't hear anything we had to say. Fear the blood that's going to be on your hands. Proverbs chapter 11, it's verse 20-something, says, he that winneth souls is wise. It's near the end of the chapter. He that winneth souls is wise. Why were these? If you're still in Ezekiel, let's look at Ezekiel 22. I'll show you another verse here. Ezekiel chapter 20. I got to 7. Ezekiel chapter 22 and verse 30. Ezekiel 22 verse 30. The Bible says that I sought for a man among them that should make up the hedge and stand in the gap before me for the land, that I should not destroy it, but I found none. How about that? The Lord said, I look for a man that would stand in the gap. Just stand in the gap. Try to keep them out of hell. He said, they don't want to hear it. God never said if they didn't want to hear it, you didn't have to tell them. He's looking for a man to stand in the gap. Are you willing to stand in the gap as a man or a woman? Maybe it's to stand in the gap to try to keep your children out of hell, your grandchildren, your nieces, your nephews, your cousins, your uncles, your aunts. They're going to burn in hell fire. Ezekiel 33:33. And when this cometh to pass, and notice what it says there. And when this cometh to pass, lo, it will come. Now, the Bible don't waste paper, does it? Lo, it will come. Then shall they know that a prophet hath been among them. You know what you want them to know in Seaford? That, hey, there's been a prophet. There's been a preacher down there preaching. There's been a preacher down there preaching. When I think about this, of course, you know, my father did street work. He was in Rock League, his prison ministry and everything, but his real work was street ministry. He just was known on the street for years and years and years. The police even protected him back then. Now they try to kick him on the corner. But he preached on the corner. He was on the corner every Saturday morning, and I forget what other days of the week he was there, but he was always on the corner. And some of these young fellows, did you say you felt like God might call you? Yeah. And everybody in here. You know, sometimes people think it's so exciting to be a preacher, like being a policeman or a doctor. You're so excited.
It's all paperwork.
Just don't pay as much, David. But it does pay, brother. It pays. But you know what God's looking for? He's looking for a man that'll stand in the gap. He's looking for a man that'll hold up.
Yeah.
You know what? I've driven through Laurel. I've driven through Seaford. I've driven through Ridgeville, Harrington, Milford, Dover, Laurel, Georgetown. If I named any of them twice, I'm getting older. But I haven't seen a man standing on the corner.
Oh.
So don't ever say you don't have a place to preach.
Because
you got a place to preach. You said they don't want to hear it. So what's that mean? We just want to come to a church. Everybody here wants to hear preaching tonight. That's why you probably came out. Amen. And you got let down when you got here. But you did come out to hear preaching. They don't want to hear it out there. But you better give it to them, because God said, give it to them.
Yeah.
How about Jonah? He just walked down the street and gave it to them. Jonah didn't even want to give those Syrians the gospel the way that they had treated his people. He wanted them to be destroyed.
Yeah.
But he walked and he gave the gospel out.
Right.
I'm going to ask you tonight, as I'm getting ready to close up here now, I'm going to ask you tonight, would you be willing to be one of those people that would stand in the gap? Would you be willing to be one of those people that say, hey, Lord, I'm a man of unclean lips, but God, if you'll use me, I'll go. here am I, Lord, send me. Would you be that man? You know, I'm just reading a few mornings ago, but you know the story when Jesus tells the disciples about the guy he gives 10 talents, and he brings 10 more. And then another guy gives 5 talents, and he brings 5 more. And the Lord says to him, he said, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Well done, thou good and faithful servant. I'll give you more. And then he gets to the last guy, and he said, hey, I went and buried that talent. And I'm bringing it back to you, Lord, because I didn't want nothing to happen to it. That's like your salvation. You got saved. Are you going to walk up to the judgment seat of Christ and say, Lord, here's my talent. This is what you gave me. You gave me my salvation. Thank you. You know what the Lord said? Of course, we know he's not going to say that at the judgment seat of Christ to cast you into hell. But he said, he told that servant, he said, oh, that was a wicked servant. You want to be that person? He said, I'm just ashamed. Man, look. Hey, can I give you that servant? That was real hard to do, wasn't it? That was a job, wasn't it? Now, it gets funny sometimes. I was walking across the gas station. I've talked to everybody. And I told these guys. So there's a cop there in Greensboro at the Exxon station. And I went like this. I was walking up to the thing. He said, oh, man, you forgot your wallet, didn't you? And I said, no, I didn't. Because I knew I was going to go in there and get a gospel tract because there was a sodomite working in there, and I wanted to give him a tract anyway, not because he was a sodomite, but because I try to give out a tract everywhere I go. So I turned around. So then now I got to give the police officer a tract too. I said, no, sir, this is what I went to my truck to get. I went to get a gospel tract, so I'm going to give you one now. And he said, oh, thank you, sir. Is that really hard to do? You know, if you think about street preaching, some of you guys think me and I, that makes me nervous. Just get up there and read it on a Bible. Yes. My dad had them on little cards. And he'd read the card. That's how he started out.
Amen.
My dad, he's nervous. He was nervous in front of a crowd. Don't think you can't do something.
Yeah.
You can do something.
Yes.
And what you do in this church, the way you support your pastor, and the way that anytime something needs to be done, the way you jump in and do it.
Amen.
Man, that's awesome. I'm not here tonight to tear you down whatsoever. I'm just here tonight to warn you and tell you the judgment seat of Christ is coming, and it's really going to happen.
Yeah.
You got it from your brother.
You can bow your heads, close your eyes, give each other privacy, because the mentality is you need to, in your own heart, deal with this. This is a matter we each need to deal with. I need to deal with this.